tell me about the hard habit to break.
So I was brought up a Catholic when I was very little, mm-hmm. and I was educated briefly, very briefly, by nuns. And I have a...
In Croydon?
Yeah, they have nuns in... What do you mean in Croydon? They've got nuns everywhere. Do you think the religious outreach hasn't hit as far as South London?
Yeah, sure. I just can't picture Croydon with nuns in it.
There's some places that can't be saved. Croydon's up there.
You're right. It's,
Ilford's
it's,
up there, isn't it?
It's... Yeah, do you know what? Ilford is the only place we toured to on Bake Off where we needed personal security.
Yeah,
so it was all this lovely sort of twee baking, and then there was just this really hench guy called Malcolm who was there to make sure things didn't go wrong, which was really unsettling. But anyway, I wasn't very long at the school because I'm left-handed, and nuns don't like left-handed people because they're satanic, apparently.
Did they make you sit on your left hand and write?
Yeah,
right
and hand? And try and eat, the, you know, eat sort of normally, inverted commas. And then essentially I left the school after I inadvertently made Sister Mary Dorothy break her leg by flicking. This isn't even the story, this is the precursor to the story, but it's like I had some mashed potato. You know, you just get a little scoop of like hard mash and it did. So I just flicked it, and she walked across, skidded on it, slipped, and then just smashed her femur into the wall, and the whole thing went concertinaed in. Yeah. Which proves that left-handed satanic. People do have satanic nerves.
That really is a yeah. bit like Damien in the Omen.
So I've always been really sort of creeped out by them, but they have this incredible power over people. Like, you know, they just enter a room and everyone just goes just very, very quiet and becomes very worried. But anyway, I was about 19 and I was doing a pantomime when I was at college. We did a Christmas pantomime. And I was dressed as a nun, as a head nun. And it was sort of around about, well, it's probably the last, or if not the second to last in the day of term. And so we were all just pissed. I mean, properly battered on stage, drunk as you like. And got through the first half, just about remembering what I was doing, full gear on. Second half, I'd had a massive slug of vody in the middle of the interval and passed out. So literally just bang, smacked my head.
In the show,
wallop the back of my head. Out cold, like concussed. Next thing I remember is blue lights. So they've got me off the stage and they've got me into an ambulance. Okay.
The audience all just... following.
And I can't really speak. I'm just coming round and I can't really speak. I don't really know what's going on. And slowly I'm starting to regain consciousness. And I'm then being run through this never-ending, like sort of hospital corridor, and people just going, quick, move. Go in. So laying there, all the curtains go across. And suddenly I'm thinking, OK, I've got a really belting pain in the back of my head, but I'm all right. I'm OK. And then I start to hear people behind the curtain going, so the sister in there is unwell. She's taken a fall.
Oh, yes.
Just going to get a couple of people to have a look at her. So I'm like, I really dry mouth. Oh, my God. I'm in full Wimple. I've got the full gear on. Massive crucifix. Like, a massive... huge...
What was the musical? Was she doing Sister Act?
It was like a kind of hybrid thing where everyone could just dress up whatever they want. I think it was something like Aladdin, but everyone got to play whatever they wanted. So it was like a real mishmash.
There's none in Aladdin.
No. A mate of mine was playing a fox. No idea what happened there, but anyway. It's like one of those. Yeah. So I got the full gear on. They'd really splashed out. So they come in and they go, sister, I'm so sorry we've had to keep you. And they start doing this because they're really, you know, they're like, we just wanted to check through and make sure you're okay. And I was like, yeah, absolutely fine. Start, comes over me and just goes. Sister, just excuse me a second, right? The next thing I hear is, the sister's fucking drunk. So there was this thing they were trying to work out what the best way to do was. They were trying to, where's she come from? Where's the nearest abbey? They didn't know what to call it. Where's the nearest abbey? Right. So they think, I've got to get out of here. And most times in those sort of scenarios, people coming into hospitals get into weird gear so they can blend in. Like they get into scrubs. I'm now as full nun trying to work out how I get into civilian clothes and leave the hospital shit-faced with a massive bruise on the back of my head, right? So I'm careening round the corridor like this. People go, oh my God, who the hell is that? Managed to get into a cupboard, take a load of it off. I'd got some jeans on underneath and walked out and got away with it. But yeah, they thought they had a pissed nun and they were trying to find the local.
Now they're looking. They're looking for a missing nun.
Yeah. So they were literally like, we need to find the nearest religious establishment and look for Sister Susan and tell them that Sister Susan's shit-faced in Addenbrooke's Hospital.
nuns can drink, right?
I don't know that...
They can drink.
Yeah. Did you know? Oh, yeah.
Tend to mind their business, man.
Yeah, aren't they on red wine? Yeah.
All the time.
Yeah.
Well, isn't that...
The blood of Christ.
That's the blood of Christ. You can't have too much of that.
Yeah, you've got to be careful
with
that.
Oh, are they a bit stingy with it? I don't know. I've never drank with a nun before.
Well, there's only, what, 7 or 8 pints to go around. You can't smash that.
Yeah, it was
bad. Definitely treated you way better because you were a nun.
Yeah, until they found out I was drunk. But, yeah, no, I got a full, like, bells and whistle service. It was, like, everything. I was blue lit down the corridor. I had my own little room. It was, like, sensational.
You didn't have a concussion or anything?
No, terrible. Yeah. Terrible. But I was so ashamed. I just went and dealt with it at home.
Were
it was
you
really
bleeding?
Bad. No, it was one of those ones where you just had a big, like...
Big egg.
Yeah, big egg on the back.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Big old egg. But it's nothing. I mean, I think I was slightly cushioned by the wimple. And they're amazingly supportive head guards.
Going to make a note of that.
Yeah.
During the interval, slightly cushioned by the wimple.
I'm married to a northerner.
Which bit of the north?
She's from Manchester, although the whole family say they're from Cheshire. Because is there any man is in the audience? She's from Sale, so they say Sale, Cheshire. That's what my mother-in-law says. But it's Manchester. Check your postcode, you lying cat. And then, anyway, they're all from Cheshire until they've had their fourth vodka. And then they're like, come at me a bitch, I'll glass your fucking head off. Anyway, I met Lindsay was in the front row of my audience, which I know is probably going to get me cancelled or arrested because it's a bit. I only met her 10 years ago. But it shows how much culture's changed. Like, I'm a bit dubious about saying... Because the power relationship's wrong, isn't it? With a microphone, I'm older, she's in the front row. It's a bit like...
You didn't.
Yes, I dated a girl.
That is literally why I got into comedy. Oh, like,
what?
Every man in my front row has been with me.
That's different.
Well, you know, I'm so sorry about that.
Now, you have, Russell Cain, you have broken protocol. Robert L. Murray.
I don't know if I'm allowed to plug a charity or not on here.
Go for it.
Prince's Trust. It's the nice prince. Trust is warranted in that sentence. And it's nice to hear the two together in a sentence, isn't it?
Oh my God.
Anyway, he's the king now, obviously, King John. Yeah. Prince's Trust is brilliant. If you don't know it, look it up.
Thanks for the update, though.
Young people. No, honestly, what they do, they take, like, 16, 17-year-old people in a really bad place and they turn them into entrepreneurs. It's amazing. I couldn't wait to get involved because I don't come from, like, a £1 million household. And it was all building up to this moment. We got invited to a garden party at St James's Palace, me and Lindsay. Not a big do, like, not a royal variety, but there's lots going on. It's going to be a small gathering. Charles is going to be there. Camilla's going to be there. I'm going to actually meet the future king, as he was at the time. And if you come from enough of a working class background and you're amongst people that are too posh, you lose, like, it's happening now. I'm starting to lose, like, the right noun, and eventually you end up in, like, a cloth cap going, can I clean your chimneys, mister?
Yeah.
You feel like such a peasant.
Yeah.
So we were on there, and my nerves just went, and I don't get nervous because of what we do for a living. So we had a bit of an irresponsible amount of alcohol on the way in just to steady the nerves. And when we get there, I am, you know, like the shit on the shoe E-list, and everyone else there is, like, Sir Ben Kingsley is the first person I bump into in the queue. So I'm already having, like, a fame panic attack. And Lindsay and her mum both have a trait where they muddle up famous people all the time. Lindsay probably thinks she's married to Nick Grimshaw, right? And so, the whole time, that's Sally from Coronation Street, and they'll go over and say it and embarrass themselves. So in the queue, Lindsay starts talking to, I forget which way around it was, Gabby Roslin or Gabby Logan, as the other Gabby, fully, and offends her. So, like, you know when you're doing your grit your teeth, put your fucking mouth shut. We're on that level before we even got in. In there, she... this is not exaggeration. She is fully speaking to Damian Lewis, who's a big patron, as though he's... I know the mistake she's made. Chris Evans, the DJ. I can see... we get out of that one, because I can tell by the language she used, so I tug her and I say...
You really love this woman.
Yeah, you do.
And you never walk away and just leave her to it.
Literally.
We have, like, a water round, because we know Charles is coming down into the garden, and we wait with our champagne, and we take... Have you done one of these informal things where you meet the... So they took us aside and they was like, right, don't panic. Charles is really chilled. You say, you don't matter if you say your highness or this and that. We've only got one rule. You don't, like, lunge forward and touch him. I'm like, obviously. You don't go, is that where the crown goes, mate, or anything? Who needs to be told that, right? So we get stuck in a line and he's coming along. And I'm annoyed with myself how much my bottle went. At the end of the day, it's just a man, yeah. But because of my peasant council estate brain, my heart's going like that. It's irrational, right? I know it's irrational. And he's coming along, and Lindsay's put her drink down and her bag in the bush. We've got her hands free, and we're all, like, neat and presentable. And it goes amazingly. Lindsay, she's charming. She's the funny one. I'm like making an ass of myself, or I can't explain. Is he like this at home? Oh yes, he is. Your Highness, we all get on. It's great. Boom, and he moves on to the next person. We completely got away with it. Everything's great. And Lindsay's like, right, let's have another round. Let's get a bit tipsy. We've done the hard work, and we'll go. And she's gone. She's seen her champagne stored in the bush, and it looks like just the back of a photographer or a random. To her, not realising it is the back of the future monarch. We've only been given one rule. One rule. She's put her hand through the flap, you know, the guys have the little flap on the jacket, round his waist and gone, sorry, babe, cleared him while he's talking. In the middle of talking to Moira Stewart. Cleared him. Just, sorry, babe, cleared him, got
Jesus
her back.
Christ.
And we're like, right, let's get wanking. And neither one of us had a clue what had happened, and the talking, you know, when the talking just dims at a party, and you're like, what's happening? Ugh. And have you ever been the person that the noise has dimmed for, and you don't know it's dimming for you? It's the word, we're like, what? And I just saw the colour drain, and someone came up with, it's all right, he's seen the funny side. And Lindsay's like filling up like she's gonna start crying. So I don't know if you fucking, one fucking two. Because if you're crying and drunk and groping,
yeah, no,
that's
no.
Not a good combo.
So it's the trifecta.
Now, all I want to do now is start having the argument that we're obviously going to have, because this is my big moment. I'm genuinely packed. This isn't wanky virtue signaling. I'm passionate about this charity, right? And she's been showing me up, so I'm like, let's just get out. But you know when someone has embarrassed themselves, so they sort of over-banter afterwards and they become a bit louder to cover over the embarrassment. So she's had a drink and she's made a beeline to speak to one last person. And this is, she actually said, my mum loves you, gold finger, and gone in with a handshake. And there was a silence and a voice just said, I'm Moira Stewart. She went.
Yeah. Jesus Christ. Yeah.
Broke, and you're still together.
Broke the king, racist muddle up, taxi.
Wow. And Rita, I married her.
Yeah. How are you not full of lead right now?
Yeah.
The next day we got an email with the Prince's Trust trying to make us, because obviously, I know it's funny now, but at the time it was obviously quite upsetting. And then we got an email from the secretary to the prince saying, oh, don't worry, everyone saw the funny side, and you haven't been barred for touching the boss on the love handles.
Oh, I love that.
And I was like, that's nice. And I forwarded it to Lindsay and was like, don't be upset, honey, I was on the road, it's all good. And she replied in all lowercase, thank fuck, I thought I'd been barred for groping Prince Charles in lowercase. See you later. And she hit reply to all.
Oh!
Fern Brady has seen more than most.
Yes, this is one of the greatest gigs I've ever done was to a nudist society in a pub in Camden. What? Do you know that it's a gig called The Good Ship?
Yes.
In Camden. It's just a normal comedy gig. The guy that runs that said to me, I've got a bit of a different gig for you. The money's really good. The money was like three times the amount you normally get paid. And he said, it is all nudists. Are you okay with that? Whenever I tell people that story, they're like, and were the nudists naked? And I'm like, yeah, otherwise they'd just be normal people. Because how would I know?
Different.
That's the point of it. Yeah. So I turned up to the pub. It was in the upstairs. There was a bouncer at the foot of the stairs, which there isn't normally for that gig. And I said...
In case they try to get out.
In case, like, normal people tried to rush up the stairs. And I just was like, I'm here for the nudist gig. And he was sort of nodded grimly and let me up the stairs. I went up. Everyone was in the nip. I was told that I could perform naked as well if I wanted. But...
And?
No, it disrupted.
Oh, okay. Stop now, then what happened?
I liked the power dynamic between us. It really firmly established that I'm in charge and you all have your balls out, so none of you are going to heckle me.
Was it all men?
No.
Yeah, it was a majority men. Oh.
No, it was a total mix of people. There was people there that were like judges, teachers. There was a married couple
there. Had
their
wigs on. How did you know they were judges?
Because they told us.
Oh, they told you?
He had a gavel on his penis.
Did you have, like, nudist material? Like, I'll do my tit set. Like,
no, they were so desperate for nudist material.
Okay.
And they, like, desperately wanted to talk to you about the nudist movement. So the editor of Nudist Monthly came over to me with his wife. And he kept saying, don't you see, once everyone's naked, no one is naked. And I was just trying to write my set.
No, everyone's like, naked. Oh, no.
Yeah.
What's it? When everyone's naked, everyone's naked. Not no one. Who is this idiot?
He's saying that we're all equal.
It's not true, is it? Even now, I've been married for 10 years, and if Lindsay walks across the landing naked, I'm still like after 10 years. After a decade to the woman I'm married to. It doesn't wear off if we all get our kit off. It stays weird.
And what does she say if she sees you walking across the landing
is
naked?
She runs.
Oh, no.
Just in the front door bag.
Yeah. Christ, Grimshaw. Yeah.
Where's my husband? Nick Grimshaw, get dressed.
But yeah, they kept saying, oh, if you want to perform naked, you can. But I was there with comedians that I work with fairly regularly, so
did
I was
they?
Like...
Did any of the other comedians perform naked?
Yeah, did anyone?
No, Mark Simmons wore an apron that had a naked man printed on it. You know, like those joke aprons. But the gig was amazing because they were just so obedient and so lovely. But one of the weird things during it was I noticed this really handsome man laughing at me, but he was holding his willy down.
Babe, I've been there.
You've had a naked gig where a man holds his willy down in the front row.
When a guy is attracted to you because of comedy, but he's confused. So he's like, hold on, she's a woman, but she's funny. I don't know.
It was so disturbing. And then, you know when you do really well at a gig? It was because it was such a good gig.
Hold on a second. So did he have a... Was he holding a boner down?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if you can see an action on TV.
Yeah, he definitely...
Maybe he was going to clap like that. Oh, bravo, on top.
He was holding his semi down.
Oh, my God.
And smiling. Smiling up at me.
As from one's point of view, is that not a bit like threatening and weird?
No, because I could put them in the balls at any point. They were not naked.
Well, that's a bit of a no-no in a nudist event.
Every time I present,
look, they make out it's not sexy. There's something sexy about it.
Oh, they say this is just.
They're very keen to make out that it's not a sexy thing, but I think it's just disgusting. when you do well at a gig, sometimes people rush over to you to tell you how well you've done. Mm. That's normally a great feeling.
Yeah.
Not when none of them have clothes on. And they're all running towards you. It's horrifying. It's quite frightening. And you just back into the corner. And also, you know how normally, sometimes at a gig, you sit at the back of the room. I like to sit on the floor. I have a sore back. And I like to write out what I'm going to say before I go on stage. Except when everyone's naked, you're not just face-to-face with people's bums in seats. It's a hairy arse crack. It's so upsetting. Then I went to the toilets after I'd been on. I'm all for gender-neutral toilets. Oh, that's fine. We should have that. But when you're redoing your lipstick and you look in the mirror and there's a 20-stone naked man like a ghost or a vision of a demon just staring back at you, you make eye contact in the mirror. That was very distressing for me. He made a face to me like, I know this isn't right either. And then I went downstairs for a drink during the interval, right?
So you stayed?
Yeah, but so everything downstairs was normal. The pub was still operating as normal. And I said to the guy, oh, can I have a beer or whatever? And he said, you doing that gig up the stairs? And I was like, yeah, but I'm just one of the comedians. And he went, it's disgusting. We have to wipe the seats clean every time they're here. All the seats. From their sweaty asses.
How did you control your sight line when you were on? Because I don't.
It really didn't bother me.
Yeah, where did you?
No, but where did you? You must have looked somewhere, or you couldn't have done the same like that with your eyes in the air. Because I don't even like looking into the. I mean, looking into the eyes of the audience would be weird.
Do you look into the eyes when you're gigging?
Never. I mean, I'll pick out faces, but imagine if you lock eyes with someone for a little bit too long, it's uncomfortable. But imagine like scrotum.
Scrotum.
Once you've seen someone scrotum, I would lose my concentration.
No, because I was a lap dancer years ago when I was a young woman, so it just becomes very...
Oh, she'd been... Really?
You left that detail out.
Yeah. Well, that was what I was going to say earlier. This idiot from Nudist Monthly kept saying, don't you get it? Once one of us is... All of us are naked, everyone... No one's naked. He kept trying to say all these slogans to me, and I was like, I know, I was a stripper for 3 years, and it just wasn't going in at all. But, yeah, when you do stripping, you do just see naked women all the time, and you just become, like, fanny blind or something.
Yeah.
So that really helped me at the Nudist gig.
Fanny blindness.
Yeah, that would help.
Oh, just a day of it would be nice.
Everyone
when you were a student, was that
too? One day of fanny blindness, wouldn't it be nice?
Money when you were as a student.
Imagine if it was for something else.
Yeah.
I wanted to feel empowered as a woman.
Okay. I don't know what reason, but...
Yeah, for money. I did it for money.
You did quite
a... I did it because I loved to dance. Like the women in flash dance. Of course I did it for money, Alan.
Now, Johnny, you would rather forget Amsterdam...
Elements of it.
Really?
Elements of it. Yeah, I must be one of the sort of few guys back in the day at that age that I like the galleries. I like the art side of it.
One of the
like
great
the
art galleries in the world, isn't it? The Rijks Museum.
Yeah.
Magnificent.
And I get dragged out there on stag do's and nefarious events that I've really, I genuinely, do you know what I mean? I'm not that fussed about partaking, and I have to find my own things to do. And it's I've always come back with like really bad stories, and I want to put this across that the subjectification of whatever of women of whatever it is. Sorry, but subjectifying women. It makes me really awkward. And we went over, and I was with the gang lads, and they were off visiting ladies of the night, and I'm like, well, what will I do? So I'll wander around the shops. And I go in this shop, and I'm looking at all the sort of marital aids and stuff. And I'm looking at the cock ring section of all varieties, shapes, and sizes. Like some were just ridiculous. One had an Allen key to tighten it.
Well, I mean, I'd have thought.
No,
surely that would be, you'd have to.
No, you couldn't stand up in it.
The chances of getting the right fit are a million to one, aren't they?
No, an Allen key can only do so much. I'd still be sat there going, come on, this was... 3 days of tightening!
And then inevitably, where's it gone? Where's the Allen key?
No!
Where's the Allen key?
Blood!
You can't ask the neighbour, you haven't got an Allen key, have you?
Well, this is why, as I'm going down and I'm going...
Not me, not this, Alan.
And I'm relatively young and healthy at the time. I had no need for a cock ring. But I get to the bottom, and it's kind of graded in size and prices. And then the bottom is just the saddest thing I've ever seen. And it was like a lost toggle off a balaclava. It was just a bit of rubber tubing with a black thing that you slide like that. And I'm going... I was just trying to think, you know, like, imagine the passion killer of putting that on your... And I thought, I might use this in a routine. You know what? I'm going to get one, because this would be... I could have some fun on stage with this. Shop's empty. Take it up, put it down, just as I do. 20 lads walking. On a stag do, right? Looking around, all having a laugh. This guy at the till turns out to have the loudest voice ever, and I swear to God... No need to be that loud, because it's your very safe purchase for your first cock ring. And you know when you're just doing that kind of, put it in the bag, please just put it in the bag. Put it in the bag, and he's like, it's your metal cock rings, you see. Sometimes, and you know them phrases that stick with you? He goes, when you finish pleasuring, it's your man, it's your woman, it's whatever. Which is when the Allen key one made sense, and you go, that's for a fucking horse. It's your man, it's your woman, it's whatever. It's your blood. And this is, again, everybody's starting to look over going, oh, is that Johnny Vegas? It's your blood can remain trapped in the penis, and it can become quite short. With this, When you finish pleasuring your man, your woman, your whatever, you simply slide the toggle, and it's your penis, she's left to go pleasuring, because the blood comes right away. By this point, the camera phones are out. No, there's no point in me going, I'm buying it for a prop. And that is just one of, like, honest to God, so many stories. I'm just so sad. I went walking on my own. There's a huge, huge, huge lady in the window. Huge lady. Very broken English. Spots me. Starts banging on the glass like she's trying to escape, shouting, Johnny Vega! Johnny Vega! And again, just as a gang of lads are walking past, and all I heard was one lad, and he went, someone's got a type. I've never met a big ball in my life. I went over the. We actually went to launch a film that we'd made for the Arts Council. Genuine, and we were like, it was a mixed gang of us, and he said, let's go for the novelty, I'm going to see one of them sex shows. And we're like, really? We had a few drinks, we said, we're going, we're in. It was the most accidentally funniest kind of tragedy. Nobody, you don't want to watch people have sex live, trust me, it's not. But it started. No, I know.
You don't want to watch people have sex live, trust me.
Well, you don't, because the lad who came out, it was Batman themed. And they hadn't spent much on the costume. So he just had, like, he looked like a mugger, but he had tiny bat wings, tiny Doc Martens, and an erection.
I think we got the title.
So there's a lady going round on a revolving bed, and he has to come out and do that and maintain an erection to and where is the Batman? You can see in his eyes that his mate's gone, I can't work tonight, will you fill in for me or something? Because he is absolutely like, I am going to kill Jeff when I see him. This is not my natural. And there was a guy drunk behind us, thank God, because he made the show. The guy is meant to get fellatio and follow her around the revolving bed, but he can't keep momentum with the revolving. So it keeps coming out, so he keeps running ahead, waiting for her. And trying to put it in her mouth. And this bloke behind us goes, fucking hell, it's hooker duck. So we start laughing. We're all like crying, laughing. And the poor guy's trying to do his best. Once he's put it in, you can see the Sunday night, the stage manager going, give the flat, keep up the flat thing. And us just sitting there crying, laughing. But you go, I'd love to come away from Amsterdam with a sexy memory. And I never have. So it's done more damage to me. So, yeah, what happens in Amsterdam can quite cheerfully steer, you know.
Ellie Taylor, you are great at multitasking.
Well.
Yes.
When you've had a baby, your whole system has sort of had a big shock, so it sort of shuts down anyway, let alone when you've had a cesarean. You've had a lot of drugs. Basically, constipation station. Okay, everything's shut. It's slow. The system's slow, right? So, and I've heard a lot about a lady's first poo when they have a baby. It's quite a thing. It's if you haven't had a baby, it's a thing. If you have had a baby, you know what I mean, right? So, I feel I sort of, it's maybe about for my kids, maybe 4 or 5 days old, and finally I feel the urge.
It's ready.
It's ready. So I'm like, I'm sort of out
but
of my head.
We?
On... I'm like mad on hormones. I haven't slept. I'm in agony from having a cesarean. I got sent home with ibuprofen. That
oh,
was it.
No,
like I've had a mild
that.
Hangover, not major abdominal surgery, but that's another story. So that's the situation I'm in. My kid is feeding, because that's all they do at that point. So I'm like, well, the kid is feeding, I need to go to the loo, well, I'll just take her with me, right? So I go to the loo with the kid. She's latched, she's beautiful, right? It's great. So I sit on the loo. And I'm like, OK, I sort of sense this is going to be...
Exciting. lengthy. Loud.
An ordeal.
An ordeal.
An ordeal.
Keep guessing.
Yes. All of these words, and I'm sitting and I'm sort of, I've got this baby in one arm, and I'm sweating, and I just know this is gonna be hard. So I'm sort of bracing myself, and I may have had a cesarean, but this felt like it was sort of the closest to a natural birth that I've had. I have sort of hypnobirth.
You end up with both.
Both, right? And it's awful. It's so scary because I think at any moment I feel like I'm going to like burst my scar, like and some kind of organ is going to flop onto the floor. We've just had the bathroom done as well,
and
those tiles were very porous. That would have been awful. So I sort of, you know, I gird myself, and eventually everything's happened. It's out. It's done. I'm released. Oh, thank. It's like I'm a husk of a human because I'm like just a drinking straw of flesh. I'm completely empty now. Everything is out.
And you're giving drink to your baby.
And that's come. Everything is out. And I think, oh, finally, thank God, we're over. Baby never broke latch. All fine, right? I think, thank God, that's over. And then I flush the loo. It's not going anywhere.
No, of course not.
So I think it's fine. It's fine. Don't panic. Don't panic. Panic. I'll flush it again. Nothing. It's like I've given birth to cement.
Yeah, you filled it.
Absolutely right.
Did it do that thing where the water sort of creeps?
Yeah, and you think, God, don't overflow the bottle. Not on the new tiles.
Yeah.
And at this point, my husband and I we've managed to sort of keep the mystique in our relationship. No toilet stuff has ever been mentioned. I've barely even mentioned the word poo in front of him, right? So it's not like I feel like
I can say... So he doesn't actually know that you go.
No, he doesn't know I've got an arsehole. So I'm like, I don't feel like I'm in the point where I can say, darling, can you come
get your hand down
situation?
There, please.
Yeah. So what I decide, the only thing that I think is sensible to do in that moment is go to the bathroom cabinet, get out a shower cap from a hotel that I've got, put on like a rudimentary glove.
Yeah.
And bending down on my hands and knees, child still latched on, using the pincer motion, I break up my own shit.
Got to. To do that.
It goes away. Child never broke latch, and I'll be honest, it's one of the most proudest achievements of my life.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But I thought the only thing I wish, Ellie, is that you'd done a sort of a YouTube video of it.
If I had another hand, I probably would have.
Just set the phone up and say, hi, today's video. We've all been there.
I spoke to another lady.
I'd leave it a minute. You know what I mean? Down there. Like
I spoke to a lady at a baby shower who'd had a similar experience, had a cesarean, done a massive first poo. It wasn't going anywhere. But instead of her chopping it up, what she decided to do was she bagged it up in a bag, put it in another bag, like an awful sort of pass the parcel situation. Then went downstairs, gave it to her husband and said, put this into the outside bin, don't ask me what it is. And it's never been mentioned again.
He didn't go. If you enjoyed that, remember to subscribe to Dave and click the notification bell so you don't miss any of our fresh content. Let us know in the comments who you'd like to see join me around the table, and head over to UK TV Play where you can stream old episodes of As Yet Untitled for free.